Summit Ave Worship. I'm Danny Lee Gemmer.
And I'm Daisy Lee Gemmer. And today is
Celebration Sunday! After worship, we'll have a Zoom for ordination of our new elders and deacons.
We'll also have a celebration and a party hat contest.
And an open house at church to drop off pledge cards and food bank donations.
And don't forget to bring a sack lunch and safely visit with your friends. Now let's continue our worship and light our Christ candle.
And read our call to worship from Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord. All earth worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
May the peace of God be with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace of Christ be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you all.
Today's scripture reading is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, verses 14 through 30, the parable of the bags of gold. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey, who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on a journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more." His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." The man with two bags of gold also came. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with two bags of gold. See, I have gained two more." His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." Then the man who had received one bag of gold came. "Master," he said, "I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you." His master replied, "You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For those who have will be given more, and they will have an abundance. As for those who do not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth."
You pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So today is our second sermon in our 3-week sermon series on stewardship. Last week, we looked at the parable of the bridesmaids and their oil lamps, and we asked the question, how are we using our time as followers of Jesus? Specifically to the Matthew 25 vision given by the PCUSA, how are we stewarding our time as a church to help eradicate poverty, to look at and dismantle and remantle systemic racism? How are we using our time as a church to build up our own congregational vitality and health? Yeah, so this week, we turn to the next parable in Matthew chapter 25, the parable of the talents. So a man goes away on a journey and entrusts his 3 servants with his property. To each servant, he gives money. The first one gets a big bag of gold, 5 talents worth, the Bible says. And then the second one gets a smaller bag, 2 talents worth, and a third bag with just 1 talent. So God's call to salvation is equal for all. But God does actually give different gifts in different measure. So, a little context. A talent was the greatest unit of accounting in Greek money. So, it's about 10,000 denarii. And if you remember from an earlier parable, a denarius was worth 1 day's wages. So, the quick math on that is that 1 talent, or 10,000 denarii, would be the equivalent of more than 30 years of daily work. In Jesus' day, that would be a lifetime of work for many. So, once again, Jesus is speaking in hyperbole. It's an outlandish amount of money that is given. And notice the verb is actually entrusted. The Lord gives extravagant gifts. It's crazy, and a crazy amount. But think, Jesus is saying, think of the confidence God must have in us to entrust us with that much. Jesus trusts you. Jesus trusts me. That always blows me away to consider that. God trusts us. So on this Stewardship Sunday, when we are all of us being asked to consider our financial commitment to the work of God here at Summit Avenue, we do well
to pay attention to the literal message Jesus is giving us, that talent means money, and how we spend or invest or bury our money matters to the kingdom of God. Also, all the money we have in this life comes in one way or another from God. It is a gift. It is a grace we have been entrusted with to use wisely and well. So the word talent can also mean gift or ability. That's what it's taken on in English. The English language is gift or ability or skill. Or basically any opportunity God has given. So however we define that word talent in the parable, it is what God gives now and will ask about later. Yeah. So let's look at those three servants and what they do with the talents the master gives them. Verse 16, the man who had received 5 bags of gold immediately went out and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. And the second did likewise. First, notice the three very assertive words in that sentence. Immediately. Went out, put to work. Like the bridesmaids in the wedding parable, Jesus says that waiting for and serving the Lord is not about passive religious inwardness. It's active and exciting. It's bringing the oil. It's putting your talent to work. It's investing in the future. It's taking risks and it's trusting. And remember that none of this activity would be possible without that first verb, which is a passive verb, the verb to have received, received. So this is what I notice here. Grace precedes work. Grace precedes work. But equally, notice that grace precedes work. You notice the difference there? See, grace presumes responsibility will follow. Okay, that third servant receives 1 talent, still a lifetime's wages. So it's no small amount. But the verbs are quite different with this one. But the man who received 1 talent went away and dug a hole in the ground and buried his master's money. He went away, he dug a hole, he buried his talent. Notice it's not active. It's not marked with excitement or action or hope. It's passive, it's fearful, it's playing it safe. Some scholars see a critique of the Pharisees here. That went away is representing the Pharisees' separatism. The dug a hole is that preoccupied with living safe lives. And the hiding of the talent is equated with the Pharisees' puritanical obsession with avoiding sinners. So it's really a judgment on the Pharisees in every age. People who consider themselves righteous, but who play it safe, and they avoid mixing with the world. People who keep their money and their talents to themselves. Yeah. Jesus is saying he is not interested in people playing it safe. He is not interested in people keeping themselves hidden from the risks and the realities of the world. In other words, talent means mission. Talent, whether money or skills or opportunity, whatever God gives us, talent is meant to be taken out and put to work in the world. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. We confess in our creeds, from thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. Yeah. The life of faith is not just receiving gifts, it is also giving account. And the first two servants say, "You entrusted me, and look what happened. I put it to work and it multiplied." See, Jesus wants us to feel good about the work we do. Why we take time out on Stewardship Sunday and on other occasions to celebrate the ways God has been faithful. God has multiplied our efforts to say, "Hey, wow, look at the food pantry and how it gets filled and emptied nearly every day. It's not just us doing the work. It's the whole community involved. This ministry has multiplied. Look at that." It's saying to God, "Can you believe how beautiful our virtual worship services have been? Summit staff and friends have shared their hearts and their time, and we have reached people around the world with the gospel that we never would have under normal circumstances." Jesus is saying it's okay to celebrate and say, "Hey, look at our groups that keep gathering on Zoom and in person at safe distances, outdoors, on patios and decks through the summer and even into the fall. Look at that. People are connecting and praying and growing in their faith. The word of God is multiplying in the world." Jesus is saying it's good to celebrate. Look at the people who are giving generously, even in the midst of a pandemic. Look at the ways that because of their gifts and their generosity, we can continue in mission and ministry. And so we celebrate, and Jesus says, "Yes, I want to hear that. Bring that to me. I want to hear it." And this is what he says: "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." We humans, we've been created goal and praise oriented. It is okay to seek honor in this world. The question is, from whom do we seek praise? Jesus says, "Seek God's praise, and God will delight in you, will rejoice over you and with you." But that third servant, let's look at him. His response is so interesting. Like Adam blaming God for his sin, "Well, that wife you gave me, she told me to eat the apple." Yeah, so this servant does something similar, and he tries to pin his laziness on God. "Master, I knew you were a demanding person, harvesting where you did not plant and gathering where you did not scatter." Yeah, Jesus is saying it's not cool to blame God, or anyone else for that matter, for our own decisions. And not only does this third servant try to blame God, he also has this attitude of, "Why even bother? You are a sovereign Lord who does whatever you want, so you obviously don't need me." See, usually it's pride that Jesus judges in his parables, but this time it's misplaced humility. It's thinking too low of yourself and believing that you don't even matter. That, my friends, is also a sin. To think so little of God's gift of life and talent and image of God grace in you that you don't think you have anything to offer. Jesus says you will be held accountable for thinking too little of yourself and not trusting yourself as much as God trusts you. Bottom line, God entrusts us with time, with treasure, with skills and gifts. So the question Jesus is asking is, what will we do with our time, with our money, with our gifts and our abilities? Yeah, it's a tender and vulnerable question, and one for which we will be held accountable. Today, Stewardship Sunday, we get to take action on that question. Today, we get to give our pledges for 2021. Many of you I know have already mailed yours in. Thank you so much. Some of you have already pledged online, also super helpful. Many of you will come today to the church and drop your pledges off. That's going to be wonderful for folks to see one another today. Giving of our pledges is an act of going out, putting our talent to work, and trusting God to multiply it. Well done, good and faithful servants. Today, we are also ordaining and installing a new class of elders and deacons. People who have said yes to serving as leaders at Summit for the next 3 years. Also an act of going out, of putting your talent to work, of trusting God to multiply and grow your offerings. And we have such a great group of elders and deacons for this class. Some brand new, getting ordained for the first time today, officers of the church. And some folks who were ordained in the past and who are returning to serve again. Well done, good and faithful servants. You have been faithful with a little, and more will be given to you. For the sake of the world and to the glory of God Almighty. Amen. And now, I am so excited to introduce you all to the Elder Deacon Class of 2023.
Hi, I'm Peg Powell, and I have just been elected to serve as a deacon this year. I've always felt like it's important to be involved in no matter what organization or group I belong to, and so serving as a deacon is a good way to do that, to be able to use, I think, one of my skills of being able to listen to people. One of my hobbies is probably photography and playing with digital images and to make cards or framed photos, or I used to do some digital scrapbooking, but I've kind of gotten away from that, but I love playing with photography.
Hey, my name is Sue Kella, and I'm going to be a deacon for the third time. I'm happy to be here again. I feel that I can do a good job at being a deacon. I love people, and there's not a person here that doesn't know I love to talk, so I can, you know, I feel like I can relate to everybody who's in my parish, and hopefully I'll be able to do a good job even in my old age. My favorite comfort food is a hamburger, and I know they're not good for me, but about every 10 days I order one, and in spite of the fact that they're not good for me. To me, they're a comfort because they're, and I also secondly like a good Chicago hot dog. And those are not good for me either, but I can still like them, and they make me feel good when I eat them. I think of family time, picnic time, but I love a cheeseburger and with all the trimmings.
My name's Tom McCrary, and I'm gonna become a deacon in Summit Avenue. This is the first time for me holding any kind of position like this at a church. I guess I'm excited to learn and to work with the other deacons, and I just hope I can do a good job of it. Yeah, my hobbies are basically repairing the house, but we didn't get to get the boat out much not even once this summer, so when COVID ends, I want to do some more fishing and some crabbing and get the boat out.
Hello, everyone. My name is Judy Hansowitz, and I'm really excited that I've been asked to be a deacon, and I'm looking forward to serving. I've received a great deal of comfort from the connections that I've had throughout my life in the church, being close to people and feeling like they care about me. But I often see people who don't have those connections, and they're just kind of by themselves. So one of the reasons that I'm looking forward to being a deacon is that I think maybe I can help them feel connected and feel that love and feel like they belong. one of the things that I'm looking really forward to doing after COVID is over has to do with being a deacon. I've missed people so much that one of the things I really want to do is to host the people in my parish at my home. A whole group of them together, not just one at a time. And that's really what I'm looking forward to, is being with people.
Betsy Cornelis, and I'm going to be a deacon. I'm excited about becoming a deacon so that I can better serve the church and the community and to get to know more intimately some of the members of our congregation. My Starbucks order is a grande black coffee, usually of the blonde roast persuasion. And every once in a while, if they're out, we have to get dark roast.
That's okay too.
My name is Jerry Wheeler, and I'm going to continue to be your elder for the next 3 years. I am really excited and have been excited about the program that we've installed in our church to revitalize it. And in the coming year, I'm really looking forward to being able to participate in that program again and to be able to get out into the community to be able to assist in bringing more people into our church, more people of difference and younger people too. We really need those. I'm really looking forward, as I'm sure that all of you are, of getting rid of this COVID so that we can all join one another again in church, which I'm really looking forward to. And so that I can go out with my friends and have coffee again and have dinner once in a while with my wife out as well. You know, there's only so much that you can do with takeout or having it brought in. It's not nearly as fun as getting out of the house.
Hi, my name's Carl Jensen. I'm a new elder since last spring. I'll be here with you as an elder for another year. One thing I'm excited about with the church and being on session again is seeing how we can, you know, broaden our outreach with our new inclusion statement that we've approved and hopefully grow our membership. Hobbies, you know, everybody pretty much knows I'm an avid bicyclist, so I do that when the weather's dry, and when it's not, I play go doors and play tennis. I love to play tennis. I play USTA old guys tennis.
My name is Lisa Barfield, and I am coming on as an elder here at Summit. I'm really looking forward to being part of the session and the leadership of the church. I've been in the church for about 20 years, and it's more than time for me to give back and lend a helping hand. The thing that I've done most during the last 6 months or so, which has been a blessing to me, is I've walked lots and lots of local trails and explored new things around Kitsap, all socially distanced, but I've really had a good time doing that.
Hi, I'm Deanna Gemmer, and I will be joining this year's class of elders at Summit Avenue. I really look forward to joining session this year in order to help us continue our efforts in crossing the river, our transformational efforts. I'm excited to listen with the elder team, to look for where God is at work, to listen to the nudges of the Holy Spirit, and to be brave in trying new things and reaching out to new people. I am not a coffee drinker. I have never really liked coffee, but I do love coffee culture. I love sitting in a coffee shop and having a drink with a friend and catching up or studying or working on a sermon in a coffee shop. So I'm looking forward to coffee shops being able to be back open when the COVID restrictions lift. And my Starbucks order is a grande iced soy chai.
My name is Chris Cornelis, and I'm going to be an elder.
I'm looking forward to being in session to spend more time with Brian Henderson and to better get to know the church and look for ways to serve. The first thing I'm going to do after COVID is have a conversation with somebody that has nothing to do with COVID and nothing to do with politics.
You go nowhere by accident.
Wherever we go, God is sending us.
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 So go with the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Holy Spirit Sustainer, this day and forevermore. Amen.